Hello.
Oh, it works. I know people are still coming in, but we'll get started. How are you guys all doing? All right, I'm David Choi, director of the Fred Kiesen Center for Entrepreneurship. Welcome to our Hilton Distinguished Entrepreneur and Speaker Series. We have a treat for you. I'm going to be very brief, but let me give you just a few factoids about Jeff Hoffman, okay? It's only like 5 pages long, but so almost. So this is why he's going to be interesting to many of you. He started a business as a college student. Eventually, he started another small company called Priceline and Ubit.com. But he also has other interests. So he produced a hit horror movie called Cabin Fever. He used to tour with Britney Spears and NSYNC. Produced a Grammy Award-winning jazz album, among other things. So also he's been invited to speak in more than 50 countries. And so it's rare that you have a great entrepreneur who's also a great speaker, as you'll see. So without further delay, let's give a, oh, by the way, he also flew in from London and Chicago to be here today. So let's give him a warm LMU welcome.
Thanks, David. Thank you. Well, thank you guys, and thanks for coming out today. Before we get started, I want to introduce a friend of mine. We were here in town filming a PBS TV show today. It's called Biz Kids, and it's about kids even younger and younger that are starting businesses. It's like a show that's won like 6 Emmy Awards. But just want to introduce my friend with me today, Rachel, stand up for a minute. This is Rachel Brooks Smith. You guys might recognize her. If you have seen the Bring It On movies, that's the evil cheerleader. If you've seen Center Stage, that's the dancer. If you've seen Chalk It Up, that's the gymnast. If you've seen 2 1/2 Men, Scream Queens, Glee, Entourage, any of those other shows, you've seen Rachel before. So we were here in town filming something. She decided to come by tonight. So I want you guys, Rachel's now an entrepreneur as well as an actress and launching, actually stand up one more time on that thing if you can, her own clothing line, which she is wearing right there. Instead of Namaste, it says Namaste. But I want you, yeah, the clothing are made entirely from recycled plastic. So she's an entrepreneur now too. I want you guys to take a chance to meet her tonight. So anyway, let's jump into this. We're going to talk about the power of entrepreneurship. And I want to tell you guys, this is not a real picture from anything. It's just representative of one day I got a phone call, only a couple years ago, where somebody asked me to come to a school and speak on Career Day. And that kind of, in fact, I'll tell you what I did. I answered the phone and I said, clearly you guys have the wrong number because by your standards, I don't have a career, right? When I was growing up, entrepreneur was not a career. Entrepreneurs were people that clearly just couldn't keep a job somewhere. In fact, you were called a hustler in the bad way of hustler, right? You're just out there hustling. And so I was amazed. They said, no, Mr. Hoffman, we called you on purpose. And I said, why? And they said, we think entrepreneur is people actually do that on purpose. So it took all this time before people recognized it is a career path. My whole life I heard this. I had one job. I'm going to tell you my background really fast in a minute here. I had one corporate job. And guys, by the way, we're not here to talk about right or wrong. There's no right or wrong. It's all DNA. I'm not telling you to be an entrepreneur or not, to be corporate or not. None of these are right or wrong. You got to do what fits your DNA. I'm just telling you, for me, this was the career. Did I talk so long it's late at night now? Jeez. I just couldn't do it. I wanted to be, my whole career, my business card never would have ever even had one. Couldn't afford them most of my life. Would never have said entrepreneur. Right, that's a word that even today, I would have never called myself. Today I can barely even spell that word without spell check. I would have just said I was a problem solver. My job is to go find a problem, solve it, and find another one. And people would say this, what's wrong with you? Why can't you just get a job like everyone else? And all my life I thought, wait, this is my job. This is what I do. I solve problems and then I finish them. I'll tell you guys very quickly, I was working on one of my startups. I'll only talk about a couple of them in the fall. And in December, my stepfather said, what are you working on? And I told him. This is in the fall, and in December we sold the company. So in February he asked me again, what are you working on? And it was something else. And I was doing something different. He said, I just asked you a couple months ago what you were doing, and you gave me a different answer. I said, yeah, we sold the company in December, and I started another one. And you know what he said? You know what, Jeff? This is going to look really unstable on your resume. Every time I talk to you, you have a different job. I said, every time you talk to me, I just sold another company. If that's a bad resume, then I guess I'm a bad employee. That's the environment that I kind of grew up in. I got an engineering degree when I went to college, but I will tell you guys this. It wasn't because, this is not a knock on engineering or anything, but I didn't get an engineering degree because all I dreamed about engineering stuff, right? I didn't get an engineering degree because that's what I always thought I was going to do. I got an engineering degree because my parents kept on saying, get a good job and get a good degree and a good subject where you can get a good job at a good company and a good paycheck. And that's what we're all raised to be told all the time, that you need to have a good degree so you can get a good job at a good company and a good paycheck, all of which is fine. Except that no one ever asked me this, are you having a good life? Because I'll tell you what, I had a good job and a good company and a good paycheck. I just didn't have a good life. I hated my job every day. I dragged in there, sat in this cubicle, looked around and said, this is it. This is what everyone's sitting in traffic and honking, and this is what the rat race is about, so I could sit here. I did all that work in school for this, and it didn't fit for me at all at that point. So I quit, and I've been just doing startups ever since. But what I've really been doing is solving problems ever since, because that's actually what I enjoy doing. So this is the most successful. I've been a part of 8 different startups. We had successes and failures. This is our biggest one. Just to give you guys an idea, this was a startup, like everybody else, on a small group of people, like on a table, literally. And this company today does business, the Priceline Group does business in 200 countries today. And this little startup that was started from scratch, I almost feel silly saying this, it's worth $76 billion today. And this was started from scratch. So apparently little companies can grow into big ones if you follow some of the lessons we're going to talk about today. After doing startups my whole life, I had made a commitment to giving back. And I had said, I had another company called Ubid.com that we built, took it public. It was like the 5th largest auction site on the internet at the time. That company was sold as well. But I made a commitment to giving back. Entrepreneurship has given me, it's been a privilege, not a job for me. And it's given me the opportunity to do a lot of things with my life that I never dreamed of doing. So I said I want to pay that debt back by mentoring. So I just want to tell you guys, in 2011, at the end of 2011, I said, look, I'm done being a CEO and building companies. I want to give back. So the intent was I took 2012 off to mentor. Here's what I was going to do. I'm going to give back to the field of entrepreneurship by mentoring other entrepreneurs. I've been very blessed to get to live a lot of my dreams and things I didn't even dream of. And I said, I'm going to give back by helping other people do that. Whatever their dream is, I'll try to help other people get there. I did this grand social experiment in 2012 that I didn't tell anybody. For 2012, I said, for this whole year, I'm going to spend a whole year and I'm going to just say yes to anybody that asks me for help with anything for a year. I just didn't tell anybody that. Wherever the phone rang, I said, sure, I'll help you with that. That means I won't spend a day in the office, I won't make a dime or do a business transaction. I'll just help people for a year. Well, when I started doing that, like the third call I got was an email from a young 19-year-old man in Senegal, West Africa, who said, things are kind of tough in the village. Can you help us? And since my challenge was, I'm just going to say yes to everybody, I just got on a plane and went to West Africa. And what happened was so fascinating that I said, you know what? I'm going to turn this into a world tour. And I'm going to go meet entrepreneurs in as many on every single continent. And I set out to do that in 2012. And I've been doing it for the last 4.5 years straight. So all I've been doing is really mentoring entrepreneurs and learning from you guys at universities all over the planet and other. This, by the way, I'll just mention, one of the crazy ideas we had was, you know, I fundamentally believe your generation, whatever you want to call them, I always tell people, if one sure way to irritate millennials, it's to call them millennials because you're putting them in a group which they don't want to be, in one lump group. But you have a generation of people that are trying to make a difference, that are focused on values and experiences, not paychecks and titles, which is fantastic. So I've been saying that to a lot of people that give the other side of the argument, oh, it's a generation of entitled kids, and I say, no, it isn't. It's a generation of people that have values because we disillusion them so much that they want to make a difference. So I'm a very practical person. I've always been more about, while everybody's talking, I'm just going to go build it and see if it works while you guys or other people are discussing it. So given that that quit telling me about it and show me attitude of doing it, we decided to prove the point. So we had this other grand experiment. We got this idea let's charter a ship. That's actually the ship. Let's sail the ship around the planet Earth, loaded with you guys, with students, entrepreneurs. Let's expose them to all the world's problems and see what they do to solve them. So we actually did this 2 summers ago. We chartered a ship. We took students from all over the world. We put them on the ship. We literally sailed around the entire planet. It took like 98 days. We stopped in countries all along the way, and we let you guys do what you were going to do. They saw, these entrepreneurs saw problems all over the world. The whole fifth deck of that ship's an incubator, and they launched companies the whole time we sailed to make the world a better place. So I've spent all my time doing this, but I got to tell you, by the way, we're going to do that again. You guys can talk to me afterwards if you're interested in being on the ship. Not this summer, but next summer. So let's talk about what entrepreneurship is. That's the entrepreneurship ship, literally. Entrepreneurship, here's a problem. When I tell people, do you want to be an entrepreneur? So a lot of people self-select and say no. And I say, well, out of curiosity, why? And they say, oh, I don't have an idea for an app. And I say, wait, who said anything about apps? And they say, well, I don't know how to build internet companies. We say, who says anything about internet companies? The problem is that entrepreneurship has got a bad name. It's poorly marketed. As a matter of fact, think about, I asked you to name famous entrepreneurs that we've made famous in our country, they're all tech, right? They're the Zuckerbergs, pick a tech company. Our heroes are all tech, whether it's a Steve Jobs and Apple, whatever it is, Google. We really make tech sexy. The one movie about entrepreneurship, the Facebook movie, Social Network, it's about tech. And it's focused on, I think that song, I Want to Be a Billionaire, came from that movie. Right? They said it was written for that movie. Anyway, the problem is, it gives entrepreneurship a bad name because people think, I have to start a tech company and I have to be focused on trying to get rich. The most successful entrepreneurs, people I spend time with that have really accomplished what they set out to, pretty much none of them ever start their sentence with, I was just trying to get rich. Okay, entrepreneurship is not about internet. It's not about making money. It's a mindset and it's a way of thinking. All right, and I want you to think about the tools of entrepreneurship, the mindset, and we're going to talk about that tonight. The DNA of entrepreneurship is a mindset. It's a way of attacking problems. It's a way of thinking. And so that's what I want you to focus on. You can apply this skill set to everything that you do in your life. You don't have to start a tech company to be an entrepreneur. Entrepreneurs are problem solvers, like I said, but here is the real reason for you to become an entrepreneur. You have 2 choices in life. You can wait and see what the future brings, or you can just design it. All right. I didn't become an entrepreneur because I wanted to make money. Money matters. You have bills to pay. You have people to take care of. But I never focused on that once. This is what I wanted. When I worked at the big engineering company I worked for, it made me nuts every single day. The arbitrary rules and the bureaucracy we had. And what I wanted was freedom from that. I said, I want to work in a more rational world. And people said, if you don't like the company, quit. And somebody else said, except all the companies are like this. So what does an entrepreneur do? I said, you know what, then I'll just go make my own company. I will design the environment I want to work in, and the industry I want to be in, and the future I want to see. The reason to become an entrepreneur is because you get a chance to design the future you want, not the one you get if you take a passive approach to that. I'll tell you where my journey started. I grew up in a little desert town in Arizona. And I lived in a place, again, I'm not judging anybody, but I grew up with people that nobody wanted, everything was fine. Nobody wanted to leave, nobody wanted to go anywhere, no one wanted to see anything. They were good, and that's fine for them. Remember, guys, this isn't right or wrong, it's DNA. But everybody I grew up with was like, in fact, the kids I grew up with still live in the same 5 mile area their entire lives, which, again, is fine, except I had dreams and I had plans and I wanted to do stuff and I wanted to go. So I believe that education was the key to me being able to chase any of the dreams that I had. And there was a specific degree in a specific topic that I wanted, except only one school really fit it, and it happened to be a program at that school right there. When I said I wanted to go there, everybody around me, first of all, you're not smart enough, you're not good enough, and people like us don't go to places like that. My guidance counselor in high school laughed at me. And I said, wait, aren't you supposed to be pushing students? And she said, well, Jeff, not towards unrealistic goals. And she didn't want to fill out the form. She said, why are you wasting your time? People from here don't go to places like that. And I was thinking, well, with an attitude like that, no wonder. I went anyway. I worked really hard. I got in. I showed up at Yale. First day of class, I went to class, and I got kicked out. They said, yeah, you didn't really pay. I said, I don't really have any money. And they said, it doesn't work that way. I said, I am now aware of that. I sent you all the money I have. She said, it wasn't enough. You can't go to class. I called my parents. I said I got kicked out, and they said, yeah, just come home, right? You can go to the local state school for free. And I called my friends. I said I got kicked out, and they said, yeah, just come home. And I remember thinking, I'm 18 years old. This is the first obstacle, real problem in my life, where I really wanted something, and I couldn't get it, and I'm going to quit? Is that the precedent you should set in your life? When things get tough, you should start out by quitting so you can learn how to do that. So you know what I did? I sat down on the stairs by myself. I couldn't go to class. And I said, I'm not going home. I'm not quitting, and I'm not leaving here until I get that diploma. But here's me, and here's a big, giant goal and a huge, huge, you know, valley between us. How am I going to get from here to there? So I started, I didn't know this word entrepreneurship, but I did understand problem solving. Here's the problem. I want this degree. Here's me down here, a million miles away from it. But I said, I'm just going to pick up a shovel and start digging. I started my first company the second day of class since I couldn't go to class. My first company, I started a software company, which would have been fine, except I don't know how to write software because they won't let me go to class, so I can't learn anything. I started a software company anyway. I went out in the community and wrote proposals. I won a software contract. Then I just went around campus and the local high schools with handwritten signs programmers wanted. And what was nice then was programmers, high school and even college kids will work for pizza, but businesses pay you actual money. So I sold my software, paid the kids, and used the rest to fund my college education. I got this degree in 4 years. And when I walked across the stage, I still didn't think I wanted to be an entrepreneur. But I'll tell you something I did learn. When you have a really big goal, a really big dream, the skill set of entrepreneurship, it's a problem you can solve. Everybody bet against me. The university, on graduation day, the treasurer of the university walked out shaking his head. And I said, what? And he said, we had a betting pool of like which week, not month, semester, or year, you would leave this campus. And he said, nobody can believe you're walking across this stage now. What I learned was you can solve problems if you develop a set of problem-solving skills. That's the only reason I walked out of there with that diploma. And I was thinking then, when I left, next time I come up against a big problem, once you've solved one, you kind of think, hey, maybe I could take a shot at another crazy thing because maybe I just can do it. So I left, and I'll tell you about that corporate job in a minute, but I want to stop there and talk about attitude, and I got to share a story with you guys just because how important attitude is. Your attitude determines your outcome. And the fact that this is really, really important because there are a lot of people you see, you might see them on TV, and it's somebody successful. And you think, well, she's just smarter than me, right? Or he's better than me. Here's the truth. They're not smarter than you, these successful people. The difference is they had this attitude. They had this DNA and this entrepreneurial attitude of focusing on the positive, of what they can do and how to go about doing it. So let me tell you the story. This is looking back that I realized about that attitude. I was 10 years old, and I went to my best friend's house next door, Mike's house. And there was a poster on Mike's wall, and it was a poster of a Ferrari. And all the guys were standing around all excited about this poster. By the way, the real poster had a picture of a pretty girl in a bikini sitting on the car. But we were 10. And I do have to tell you, I remember what my best friend said then. He said, that is so disgusting. That girl's bare butt is touching that fine car. She needs to move, okay? And so I went home. So I took her off of here. I went home and I said to my mom, I said, Mom, I got a question. And my mom said, what? And I said, I don't understand. And she said, what? And I said, I don't understand the fascination. My mom said, what was the poster? And I said, it was something called a Ferrari. I'm not a car guy, so I don't even know what that was. And my mom said, oh, that explains it. And I said, what? And she said, the fascination is it's unattainable. I said, oh, my bad. I thought a Ferrari was a real thing. My mom said, no, that's a real car. And I said, then how could it be unattainable? And I said, my mom said this. She said, son, neither you nor anyone you know will ever drive a car like that. That's why it's unattainable. I said, Mom, why? She said, son, it's a $1 million car. 0.001% of the population will ever drive that car. And I said, but that could be me. And she said, no, neither you nor anybody you know is ever going to drive a car like that. Now, in her defense later, my mom said, I was just trying to help you, to keep you from having unrealistic expectations, but it didn't work. I said, wait, time out. I said, again, someone drives this car? My mom said, yes, just not you. And I said, why not me? Why could that? No, guys, I don't even like cars. I'm not a car guy. That wasn't the point. The point was you let the world set your limits. Why do you do that? Why do you let anybody tell you what you're capable of until you find out on your own? So I went to school, and I said to my friends, just curious, I said, when I grow up, I'm going to drive a Ferrari. And remember, guys, I'm not even a car guy. That wasn't the point. And everybody laughed. I said, why is that funny? And they're like, dude, you're never going to drive that car. And I remember thinking, if everybody accepts that belief from the start, they will never drive that car. I don't even want the car. I just don't want to be told I can't have it. Okay? So I went to the mall and I bought a poster, this poster. And I went home and I took the poster and I wrote some things on the back of it. And I wrote a list and I said, if I can prove these things true and make this list of things happen, then I'm going to buy that car only to prove it can be done. Right? Because when you accept the world setting your limits and telling you what you can and can't do, you've already put a ceiling over yourself. Right? So don't do that. Only you determine what you're capable of achieving. Like I said, I didn't even want the car. I just wanted to buy it to prove that it could be done. So I wrote this list of things, and I said, if I ever check the last thing off this list, I will go buy this car because I don't believe it's not possible. I wanted to at least give myself a chance. By the way, just a funny story. When I was in high school, I was getting ready for football practice, and I was looking for something in my closet, and something fell, and I picked it up, and it was that poster. And I unrolled the poster, and I was looking at it. And my mom came in, and I was staring at this poster, and she said, oh, I see you found that car again. And I was looking, and I said, wait, what car? My mom said, you finally spotted the girl. I was 18 years old now. And my mom said, I said, how did I miss that before? And my mom looked at the pretty girl, looked at me, and she said, son? And I said, what? And she said, you ain't getting one of those either. I said, geez, thanks, Mom. And I said, Mom, can I ask you one more question? And she said, what? And I said, suppose I had that car. My mom said, fine, that girl would probably show up. We laughed about that. So your attitude of allowing the world to set your limits already starts you off in the hole. I never really believed that. And it started with, I told you, I always had big dreams. And if you are a dreamer, you have been told many times, in a negative way, sadly, that she's such a dreamer. He always has all these crazy ideas. You know what? If you've never heard that, maybe you should push a little harder. And maybe you should make your dreams a little bit bigger. But that's what it all starts with. And I started to notice that as I met successful people around the world, the most successful ones all started with a dream. Something drove them to get up every single day. So I want to share with you that relationship. By the way, when I talk to kids, which I do a lot, when I ask children, what do you want to be when you grow up? What are your dreams? Every kid has an answer. But as you scale up, I've been doing this. I ask older people. And when I get to a certain adult age, when I ask what their dreams are, what they are going to plan to do with their life, they roll their eyes. I was like, why are you rolling your eyes? And they say, Jeff, you got to grow up at some point. And I say, wait, what does that mean? And they say, well, at some point, you have a mortgage, a husband, a wife, kids, a car payment, whatever it is. And they said, you got to grow up. And I said, so wait, what happened to your dreams? And they said, I just told you, it was time to grow up. And I always look at people and think, is that growing up, guys, or is that giving up? Who said you have to stop anything you've ever dreamed of doing? You have to stop doing it because you have to have a job and be a grown-up. Somehow in society, we accept that dreams are, we accept the fact that our job is this thing that gets in the way of our life, right? Thank God it's Friday. You know why we say this in this country? Because people hate their jobs. And I always say, what happened to can't wait till Monday? On Sunday nights, my friends used to say, oh, it's another, they were depressed. Monday, got to go back to work and start another week. And I used to say, really, you got to go to work? Because I get to go to work. I can't wait for Monday. I love my weekend, but I also love what I do every single day. I'm actually excited to do that. And I wonder why people accept the difference between dreams are things that are irresponsible and jobs are things that are responsible. What I'm here to tell you guys today is don't buy that from anybody. You know what entrepreneurs get to do? They get to say, here's what I dream of, and here's my responsibility list, and I'm going to design a life that has both of them. Let me show you how that works. But I'm going to tell you this first. The first thing you got to do is write your dreams down. And I'll tell you why you got to write your dreams down, because then you can't hide from them anymore. What adults do is they, when I would ask people, tell me what you dreamed of when you were growing up, they don't want to have the conversation. You know why? Because they don't want me to remind them of all the stuff they decided not to do because they're a grown up now, all the dreams they abandoned. So I'll tell you what I do. I write mine down. At any given point in your life, if I asked, no matter what age anybody in this room is, if I said, tell me one thing, just one thing you still want to do with your life that would make your life worthwhile. By the way, I'm going to tell you my definition of success because it changed. Society teaches us that success is money, power, fame, or some combination of those. But mine's changed. My definition of success is any human being you meet that can turn around, look at their life behind them and say, man, what a ride. Somebody that loves their life, that says, I've made mistakes, but I wouldn't change anything. That's who you should be jealous of. That person may not have any money, any power, or any fame, but they are having a life they love. I have very wealthy friends who are miserable. I have very famous friends who are miserable. I have friends that have none of those things that just say, man, what a ride. That's my definition of success. Be jealous of people who love their life, regardless of how they got there or what they have in it. So again, I started to notice that those are the people that didn't let their dreams go away. So I write mine down so I can't hide from them. I write my dreams on little index cards. And you know where I stick them? I stick it on my bathroom mirror. You know why I stick it on the bathroom mirror? Because where am I at the end of every day? I'm brushing my teeth. Last thing I do. You know what I see in the mirror? I see my dream. You know what I ask myself? What did I do today to get any closer to the thing I dreamed of when growing up I was going to do? You know what happens every morning when I'm brushing my teeth? I say, what will I do today to make any of my dreams come true? So let me tell you the real story in my case, because I want you to do the same. And I'm challenging you to write something down, stick it on the mirror. Mine, when I was a kid, when I was in trouble, somehow I wound up in my room alone a lot. When I was in my room alone, and I was in trouble, and I just didn't want to think about it, this was my escape. I had a globe in my room. And I used to take the globe and spin it and close my eyes and just point. By the way, the earth is 75% water, so you got to spin four times. But eventually you get a country. And I would land on a country. The first one I ever did was Morocco. And so to escape my troubles, back then we didn't have the internet. They were encyclopedias. I looked up Morocco, and I spent the whole rest of the time in my room researching Morocco. By the time I went to bed, I was dreaming of far-off places where my problems didn't matter. In fact, it felt so insignificant what I was upset about. By the time I finished researching Morocco, and there were camels, and there was trekking in Marrakesh, and belly dancing, and food served in these clay pots on the floor, and I'd dream of far-off places. So when I was a kid, I wrote that down. Before I die, for me to look back one day and say, man, what a ride, that I liked my life and I spent my time on this earth well. You ever heard that saying that I think it's Mark Twain. The two most important days in your life are the day you were born and the day you find out why. That really stuck with me the first time I saw that. What is your purpose? What are you here to do? And I kind of thought mine was to meet people around the world. So I wrote that down when I was a kid, visit 50 countries in my life, and that'll make it a good life for me. That you, whatever yours is yours. Write it down. So I told you the story already. I took the corporate job because I was pressured into it. I was sitting in my cubicle in the engineering company one day. And here's what happened. I told you I hated the job. I'm sitting in there one day, and it's lunch. And it's like the old Flintstones cartoons. The bell whistles, and everybody runs out because it's lunchtime, and it's time to go. You can't wait. I go on the elevator. When I get to the elevator, I see this guy I know. And I'm like, Brian? And he's like, Jeff? I said, what are you doing here? He said, Jeff, I work here. He said, what are you doing here? I said, I work here. I was like, how is a friend of mine in the elevator in the building? We work in the same company. I've never even seen you. I don't even know that. And I said, where do you work? And Brian said, I work on 6. I'm in marketing. I said, oh, well, that explains it. He said, what? I said, I'm an engineer. I work on 4 in engineering. Obviously, we don't go to 6. That's marketing. And I went home that night, and I was brushing my teeth, and I was looking in the mirror, and I saw that. And I literally dropped my toothbrush. And I thought this to myself, how am I ever going to visit 50 countries in my life? I don't even visit the 6th floor, okay? One time, I kid you not, I got off on 5, and I was like, where am I? And I ran back to the elevator. So I don't even know what 5 looks like, let alone 6. And I'm going to visit 50 countries. So you know what happened? That Friday, I quit my job. Now, given that, you should be a little less surprised that Priceline's a travel company. Gee, what did I tell you? Entrepreneurs take their dreams and their career and weave them together. Why don't you create a job that lets you do the things that you want to do with your life? Why do you accept otherwise? So I'm going to tell you about this company in a minute. But cut to not that long later. My friends call me on a Saturday, big college football game. They said, you coming over to watch the game? I said, I won't be here. I can't. And they said, where will you be? And I said, I'll be in the Netherlands, in Holland, windmills and tulips. My friend's like, how are you going to Holland? And I said, check it out. This is the coolest thing ever. It's my job. And they're like, what? I started a company, this is way before Priceline, that created products that were purchased by airlines around the world. So what happened was KLM, Royal Dutch Airline, never even heard of that. KLM, Royal Dutch Airline called me and said, Mr. Hoffman, we're interested in your product and your new company. Can we fly you? Can you come to the Netherlands? And I said, I can't really afford it. And they're like, dude, we're the airline. It doesn't cost anything. And I said, I can't afford the hotel. And they said, we also own the hotel. And I said, wait, so you're asking me if I want a free trip to Holland? And they said, yes. I fly over there. While I'm there, they said, you ever been to our country before? I said, no, sir. And he said, any way we could talk you into staying the weekend and taking a tour on us? I was like, seriously, I'll get back to you. Right? They want to give me a free tour of Holland. When I'm leaving, the guy figuratively, almost literally, the guy says, I'm touring one of the 50 countries it was on my list because it's my job. And on the way out, the guy said, oh, don't forget your check. I said, what check? He said, we're buying your product. I said, seriously? You're paying me to do this? I designed a job that incorporated my dreams. I'm going to tell you about the actual company in a minute, but I just want to give you an idea of how you get there planning-wise. One of the other things that was on my mirror was this. Hey, I told you I'm an engineer, but I wanted to produce. I love music. I love creative people, and I love being around them. So that was something I wrote. Before I die, I wrote three things, actually. I want to produce a concert in my life, which is pretty tough if you're a software engineer. I want to go on a tour, somewhere on a tour with some musicians, because I'd see tours all the time. And I want to go to Hollywood and just make a movie. Just produce one film. Even if they don't go anywhere, I want to do those three things before I die, because they're things I always wanted to do. So I'm going to tell you a story about both attitude and about how you attack a problem or an industry. This is what you got to do. You got to solve a problem in an industry that you want to be in. So I'm going to tell you that story in the music industry, because I'm over here, the music industry is there, but I kind of want to do something in it. And I have no lead, no opening, I'm a million miles away from it. So I want to talk about that. But the formula, this was my theory. If my dream is to do something to produce a concert, let's say, right? Then you got to go study an industry. And let me tell you literally what I did. I made a list of all the problems that exist in the music industry, all the steps it takes to produce a concert. And then I started crossing off all the ones I can't do. I can't sing. I can't write music. Trust me, I can't dance. You don't want to see that. I made it crossed off all the things I can't do. But at the end, there was still some stuff on there. There were problems in the music industry. When I started talking to people, everybody wants to tour, but they're all artists and they don't know how to produce a tour. What does producing a tour or a concert take? First of all, somebody's got to finance it. Guess what? I actually know how to do financing and raise money. That's something I've done before. Write plans, write spreadsheets, and do forecasts. I can do all that stuff. You know what? At the back end, somebody's got to actually market and promote and sell a concert or a tour. I'm pretty good at that too. So I realized if I solve a problem for the industry, I can finance a concert and I can market a concert. I can't do anything in between. But if you could become valuable in an industry by solving a problem for them, you get a chance. So let me just tell you this story. I told you guys I always wanted to produce a concert. So just very quickly, when I was in high school, one Saturday, my sister and her friends, I was in high school, they were in college, and they were all in the house, like all excited over some photos. And I said, what's this about? And my sister said, oh, we saw Elton John live last night. And I said, let me see the pictures. Well, the pictures were like a firefly and a trillion people. I said, were you even sitting in the building? She said, we're really bad seats. I said, you can't even see Elton. She said, Jeff, we were in the building with Elton John live, one of our favorite artists. And I said, well, you seem awfully excited. And she said, we saw him live. Now, one of the things I didn't tell you why I failed at corporate life, I know someday they'll do an autopsy and they'll say that my DNA was 98% sarcasm. And it turns out that corporate America fails to value sarcasm the way I do. So it didn't go too well. But given that DNA of sarcasm, when my sister said they were so excited because they saw Elton John live, I was walking away, and I said, you know what, someday when Elton and I are friends, I'll tell him you like his music. And they burst out laughing. And I whipped around, I said, why is that funny? And my sister and her friend said, because in a million alternate lifetimes, you're never going to be friends with Elton John. Okay, so I'm walking away, and I'm thinking this, could I? Is there any path at all that I could ever actually, and remember, I'm in a little Arizona desert town that nobody ever leaves. So the truth is, probably not, right? From where I am in my little town to looking up, meeting Elton John, probably not. So here's the reason that I'm telling you this. When you have a big dream and you are at the beginning of it, you look up and it's a big mountain, right? So when you're looking up at a big dream and you tell somebody something you want to do with your life and it sounds huge and it sounds silly and they laugh at you, here's what happens. You get discouraged because when you're looking up, you say, geez, that mountain is way taller than I thought. What is the path? This is a world famous Sir Elton John. How am I going to find this guy? Right? So when you're at the bottom of the mountain, you look up, the mountain looks too tall. It's slippery. It's steep. I'll probably get hurt. I'll fall back down. You won't do it. But I came up with an idea that I've been doing ever since that I want to share with you guys. Plan your goals backwards. So I couldn't find a way from where I was to there. So here's what I did. I projected myself. What I want you to do is project yourself in the some place you want to be in your life and then work backwards. So let me tell you how that works. I said, okay, just for the heck, I'm going to try this. I'm friends with Elton John. What had to happen the day before? I had to spend enough time with him to become friends. What had to happen the day before that? I had to be introduced to him and get a chance to spend time with him. What had to happen the day before that? Somebody had introduced me to Elton John. What had to happen the day before that? I had to know somebody who could introduce me. And the day before that, I had to know somebody who could introduce me to that person. And the day before that, I had to meet someone in the music industry. And the day before that, I had to have some reason anyone in the music industry would talk to me. And the day before that, I had to learn some skill in the music industry so I could get that first meeting. You see where I'm going? By the time I was done, I was all the way back and I looked down and I said, whoa, it might be one in a million, but there is actually a path. Plan your goal backward. Project yourself somewhere you want to be in the world and then say the day before that and the day before that and draw your path that way. When I was done, I thought, you know what? It's not totally impossible. So just for fun, I will show you this day. This was a while ago, but Elton and I were doing a charity concert together. And what was cool about this day was my sister called. Now, I had long since forgotten this, but it was a funny conversation because my sister said, hey, are you busy right now? I said, yeah, I'm doing a concert. I'll call you back later. We had 30,000, whatever it is, screaming fans. This was actually in Phillips Arena in Atlanta. We had 30,000 screaming fans, or whatever that place, sellout crowd. And Elton was saying, are you going to introduce me or not? And I was getting ready to go. And I'm talking to my sister. I said, I will call you back later. And actually, it was even funnier because she said, what are you really doing? I said, I'm doing a concert. She said, with who? I said, with Elton. He and I are doing a charity event together. She said, who are you really with? So it's kind of funny because I handed him the phone. And he said, hi, this is Elton. And my sister said, give the phone back to my brother, jerk. Okay? And then she said to me, he goes, oh, your sister doesn't like me. And then she said, tell your friend that's not even a good British accent. So at that moment, it occurred to me. I took that picture right then because that's the moment I thought, wow, I am standing in the moment that could never happen in a million alternative lifetimes. This was, I remembered right then when my sister had said that. I'd long forgotten. Here is the point. If you accept that this moment could never happen, it ain't ever going to happen. It's you leaving every door open a crack. That little ray of light of some dream of yours, if you don't close the dream all the way, that little ray of light is what guides you through the darkness. I always believe things are possible until I'm proven otherwise, instead of the opposite, assuming things are impossible and letting the world tell you that. So I'll skip the rest of them, but I told you guys then later we wanted to, well, I'll tell you one quick thing. Later we wanted to we did the concerts. Later we wanted to do the tours, which I'm hesitating because the picture is embarrassing. But this was me when we did the NSYNC tours, when I was on tour with the boys, Justin Timberlake standing over my shoulder there. But I'll just tell you one quick thing. One night I was with the boys on tour, Heinz Stadium where the Pittsburgh Steelers play, 70,000 screaming fans that night. We were in the tunnel where the Steelers, the boys wanted to see where they come out. We were standing there, the stadium was shaking, and I just am telling you the story for attitude. I turned to Justin Timberlake and said, did you ever in your wildest dreams imagine you'd be standing here right now? 70,000 seat stadium sold out two or three nights in a row, whole place is rocking. And Justin said something really interesting to me about entrepreneurial spirit. He turned to me and he said, hey, Jeff. And I said, what? And he said, did you ever dream that you'd be the guy standing here with us? And the answer is, yeah, kind of. Guys, give yourself a chance to do anything you want to do. I won't waste your time on this, but it was kind of the same attitude when we went out to Hollywood to make a movie. When we came out here, we'd made a bunch of independent films. I'm just showing you that one because it was our first film. But once again, everybody's attitude was, it's not going to work. You shouldn't do it. You can't do it. It's something you don't know. We made this movie for, I think, $1.3 million, which is real money, but it's not Hollywood money, and it grossed in 46 countries later about $100 million. So apparently you can do it. The last one I want to show you about that was last year I won a Grammy. That's me on the red carpet taking pictures of all the paparazzi. But I'll tell you a funny thing. They're all screaming at me, we take the pictures, put your stupid phone down. I was like, really? Somebody said, Mr. Hoffman, how does it feel? By the way, they're all yelling, Jeff, Jeff. And I was like, wait, how do they know my name? And the little guy with the headset, or it's a girl, whispers, because I'm holding a big giant sign that says your name on it, right behind you, rookie. But anyway, somebody said, Mr. Hoffman, how does it feel? And I remember saying, well, I'll tell you what I said first. I said, this is the dream of software engineers everywhere. Dead silence on the red carpet. They're like, what? I said, never mind. But it was the same thing. Someone said, did you ever think you could ever? No, Grammy was never a dream. That's not the point. The point is that attacking a problem, having a big dream, figuring out how you can make yourself valuable somewhere in an industry and then planning your path backwards actually work. None of these moments would have happened if we believed they wouldn't. So what I want to do now is just share some of the keys. If you want to be an entrepreneur, here's some of the things that you got to get right. Here's the first one. And I'm just going to share a few and then we'll be able to take some questions. The first one is to solve real problems in the world. And the reason that I say that is that I see so many people that have a solution looking for a problem. They come and show me, here's this thing that they designed that they think is really cool that no one's going to use. Entrepreneurs do something that everybody else doesn't in the world. Here's what they do. When you see, every day when you're out in the world, you see problems, right? You have to run an errand at lunch, and it's supposed to take 45 minutes. You have an hour for lunch, it takes 3 hours. When you get home, people say, how was your day? Horrible, those idiots made me stand in line for 3 hours. That's what we do, we complain, right? And you might, you know, you literally might tweet out, those idiots made me stand in line for 3 hours, wasted my whole, ruined my day, change your status to irritated, whatever. But you go back to your life. Entrepreneurs do three things everyone else doesn't. They stop and they say, hold it. Is this a big problem that bothers a lot of people? If the answer is yes, by the way, that's market sizing in class. It takes like 10 seconds, really. The second thing they do is the value equation. They look to see, they do the research. Is there a solution to this problem that I just don't know about? Is this problem solved or is there a way to fix it? And if the answer to there isn't already a solution, if the answer to that is no, there's not already an answer, then entrepreneurs do a third thing everyone else doesn't. They say, you guys go home without me. I ain't leaving here till this is fixed. So I want you to think, next time you encounter a problem, so many friends of mine that created created very successful companies did so to solve their own problem. Like a friend of mine one time that was listening to a song, and he's like, I love this band. I'd love to find more music like this. And no one knew how to do that, so he sat down and wrote Pandora for himself because he was trying to find a song. And then a friend said, wait, this is cool. Can I use it? And then another friend. By the way, he gave it to 20 people, and within 2 weeks, 5,000 people were using it. He gave it to 20 people and said, don't give this to anybody. It turned out to be a useful tool. I can tell you a whole list of stories like that. So here's mine. I told you I quit my engineering job. I'm standing in line. I bought an airline ticket to go visit a friend to talk about a business idea. I am unemployed and broke. My parents are yelling at me, what kind of idiot did we raise? You had a good job at a good company and a good paycheck and you quit. I quit because I just didn't have a good life, which turned out to be relevant for me. I buy an airline ticket, which when you're broke, that's a big expensive thing. I'm standing in line at an airport, waiting to go on this flight. It takes 1 hour to get to the front of the line. When I get to the front of the line, I miss the flight, so I'm really irritated. I get to the front, the woman says, next. She looks at my ID, Hoffman, she hits print, hands me a boarding pass, says, next. I said, wait, you gotta be kidding me. I said, I stood here for an hour and you hit print? She said, sir, you have to have a boarding pass to get on a plane. I said, I understand that, but I stood here for an hour and you just hit the print button. She said, sir, you have to have a boarding pass to go through security. I said, ma'am, I get that, but it's a printer. Just let me hit print. I stood here for an hour. She said, next. So I turned to all the people behind me and I said, am I the only one that thinks it's insane that we stand here for an hour to get a printout? A boarding pass is just a barcode on a sheet of paper. And everybody groaned, and I said, hey, I might be onto something here. Then I asked the second question. I said, this is called value equation, because the definition of a value equation is simply this. Will people pay you more than it costs you to get your product? If they won't, you have a hobby. If they will, you have a business. Okay, that's the difference. So I said this. I said, would anybody in this line give me $5 if I could give you a boarding pass right now and you could skip the line? Guys, people in the back of the line were yelling, $15, $20. I said, okay, I'm on to something. That is when I said the third thing. I said, figuratively, because no one was listening to me anymore, I said, you guys wait here, I'll be back. That Friday, I started my first company. We designed, patented, invented, and put in airports all over the world the check-in kiosk. When you go now to get a boarding pass at an airport, we pretty much invented those. And that was our first startup. We solved a real problem that people would pay you to solve, that people all over had. That's why I was in Holland. KLM Royal Dutch Airlines called and said, wait, you got a machine that people can check themselves in at the airport and we can let all these employees go and the airport can run smoother? I said, yes, sir. And they said, we want to fly you to Holland. So suddenly I had a job where I was traveling around the world, which was my dream, but I was running a company and building something. And guys, I told you, I'm not a money guy. I've never been owned by money or never focused on it. But I'm going to tell you this just so you understand what happens when you create value in the world. 3 years later, we sold the company for over $100 million. I mean, it's not internet money, but I was 20-something years old and we sold our company for over $100 million. That's what happens when you solve real problems in the world. And I'm going to tell you the single most important lesson I learned of that, out of that, probably the most important thing I can share with you tonight, and that's this. Don't chase money, chase excellence, because money follows excellence. This is the most important lesson I've ever learned. Never once have I been focused on money, and every single time I wound up getting paid. People that focus on money quit when they don't see it. Startups are hard. Entrepreneurship is hard. If all you care about is money, then the day no one's paying you, you'll quit and you'll go home because you don't see any money. People that are driven by some bigger dream, right? Some bigger goal and some bigger purpose, they're the ones who succeed. People driven by passion and purpose far outperform people driven by paycheck. But when you focus on excellence, listen, today they teach you early on with startups. They say, what's your exit strategy? And I always sit there and think this, what's your entrance strategy? What are you guys exiting, your PowerPoint? You haven't even built anything and you're figuring out how you're gonna spend the money? Seriously? So many people are so focused on exit that they don't ever create excellence. Stay heads down focused on excellence and you will wind up getting paid. Worry about nothing else, because until you achieve excellence, no one's gonna buy anything from you anyway. You don't have an exit until you do that. If you think about our other company, Priceline. Priceline was, in all these years, was never sold, never acquired, never had to be. The reason why, by the way, I don't know if you know this, but Facebook was about 90 days from bankruptcy when that deal was done. If it hadn't been purchased, it would have died. They didn't make money from the business because early on, it was a cool idea, but not a great business. Obviously, all that's changed since. But I'm just using the Priceline example. When they said internet companies back then couldn't make money, we built a company that makes, I think the sales are closing in on $20 billion a year, and the profits are about $4 billion a year. Why would you sell that? That's how it became a $76 billion company, because it's operationally excellent, and it does really, really well year after year after year. Create excellence, and you'll never have to worry about anything else. I want to share this lesson, and I'm going to move fast so we have time for a few questions. I got to take Hope Solo off of here. Sorry, Hope, but you did this to yourself. Well, it's true. She is no longer the captain. Win a gold medal at one thing. People come up to me, entrepreneurs, and they say, Jeff, I got six ideas. And I say, great, get rid of five of them. And they say, well, someone else will take them. Look, guys, here's the deal. Creating excellence at anything is hard. If you're going to do six different things, you're going to spend your time 1/6 of six different projects, you will never be excellent at anything. The world's best companies got that way by winning a gold medal at something. Let me give you two quick examples. In the early internet days, we used to talk a lot. The internet guys, like Jeff and Pierre were creating eBay. The other Jeff was creating Amazon. We all used to talk all the time at the beginning. Jeff's goal was always for Amazon to be the marketplace of everything. But for 7 years, he only sold books. That's the part people miss. What Jeff said when we talked in the early days is he said, I'm going to be the best darn bookseller on the planet. When he won a gold medal in books, you know what you and I did as consumers? We said, wow, it's only a book, but what an amazing company. I want more. I want to buy more from you. This is another friend of mine I go on the speaking circuit with. His name's Tony Hsieh. His company is called Zappos. Today, Zappos sells all kinds of products. But for years, Tony said, I am going to be the best darn shoe seller on the planet. Until he won a gold medal in shoes, having the discipline to do one thing well. When we started, people said, man, Jeff, you have a travel company. You should sell luggage and insurance and vacation plans. And we said, you know what? We're going to win a gold medal in hotels. When we do that, then we can talk about the other things. In Priceline's case, Amazon and Zappos expanded to a lot of products. 90-something percent of Priceline's billions in revenue was all hotels. We were it's literally the largest seller of online travel in the world and the largest seller of hotel rooms. We won a gold medal in hotels. And then we did it another country and another country, and today it does business in 200 countries. Win a gold medal at one thing. Find something you can do in your life better than everybody else and quit trying to do six things at once. It doesn't work. I can give you many Amazon and Zappos examples of people who have had the discipline to be the best darn bookseller on the planet for 7 years before they sell anything else. And I cannot find examples of people who launched six things at once and were equally successful. Harvest ideas. I'm going to kind of skip this, except for one slide right now. Learning. Right? Learn something new. We just don't have time to do this part today about info sponging, but learn something new every day. Learn something that's not in your major, is what I'm telling you something. Learn something that's not in your interest. Every once in a while, read an article about something that you have no idea why you're reading it at the time. I spent my whole life, and our strategy has always been, the most successful, again, entrepreneurs or people, the ones whose companies and ideas work, were the ones that spotted five different things going on in the world and said, if you put all these things together, it's a new trend. It's a new opportunity. They saw the puzzle pieces fitting before anybody else saw them, right? I recently did an event up in Silicon Valley. It was Obama's Global Entrepreneurship Summit that I spoke at, but other founders spoke. Zuckerberg spoke, but Travis spoke. He created Uber. Brian spoke. He created Airbnb. And we were all talking about the fact that none of these ideas came from staring at the taxi business, right? That's not where Travis came up with Uber. And Brian didn't come up with Airbnb staring at hotel rooms. They looked at a bunch of different things happening in the world and said, I can combine these into a new business no one's ever thought of before. That's the value of that. Literally every day while you sleep, something happened in the world that changed the landscape. Every day when I wake up, I go online, I try to see if any new cool thing happened in the world, and I ask myself that question. What could I do today that I couldn't even do yesterday? What could I be the first person to see before anyone else ever spotted that trend and create something that no one's thought of yet? That's your job. You won't get that if you only ever study one subject. You'll get that by opening your mind and reading all kinds of articles about all kinds of industries to see where innovation is happening everywhere in the world. By the way, that's what our company came from. stories about distress inventory, perishable commodities, dynamic pricing. None of these things had anything to do with each other. They were just different things we studied and learned that we had no idea what we were reading at the time. And one day we said, holy crap, we could create a dynamically priced distress inventory distribution system for perishable commodities, and that's the $70 billion company today. This would not have happened. The name your own price reverse auction technology would not have come from staring at airlines. It came from looking at what's going on in the world around me and how can I assemble those pieces in a way no one else has. I want to stress this. People say to me, before I wrap up here, people say to me, well, Jeff, why do I need this college degree? Some of the stuff I'm learning, why can't I just quit and start a company like you did? I finished my degree. And I'm going to tell you why this is so important. It's not the stuff that you're learning. This is what people miss. When they say, do I need an education? By the way, the story of a college dropout succeeding on the internet, that's a sexy story, so the news covers it. But let me tell you something. For every one of those, if you pick 1,000 successful companies, entrepreneurs, for the one college dropout, the other 999 were successful because of their education. So what I want to ask you is, whose odds do you want? Do you want to be the one in a million that does it without, or do you want to be the one have the odds of the other 999 people that are successful because they were well-educated? Why is that? Because it's not what you're learning here. It's not, I will be honest with you, no one has ever wheeled into the parking lot, jumped out of their car, ran into my office and say, Mr. Hoffman, quick, I need the square root of this number. Because I learned how to do that in school. No one's ever asked me to do it again. That isn't the point. Here's what you learn in school. You learn how to learn. You learn structured thinking. You learn problem solving, critical thinking, analytical thinking, research skills. So now you want to know how, as a software engineer, I was able to crack the music business, the movie business. Now we're doing television. Then we did an internet company. Because at my university, I learned how to learn. I know problem solving. I know research skills. I know team building, right? I learned what structured and critical thinking are. The technique of learning is what you're doing here. So your odds of succeeding are many, many, many times higher by getting the degree and the education you're getting right here. Don't drop out to become an internet sensation or whatever that is. Be part of a great team. I only mention that. You've heard this 1,000 times, network, network, network. Well, guess what? It's true. If you come into this room and you leave without introducing yourself to one person you didn't know before you came in, you might have just missed your co-founder, your investor, right? Your teammate, employee, who knows, it could be a future spouse. Whatever it was, that person you walked past without speaking to might have changed your entire life and you didn't even say hello. The most successful people are the people that know that you never, ever stop building your network by meeting people everywhere. Every company I built, when I needed somebody that I didn't have, a skill that I didn't have, I always knew somebody. I'd say, oh, that girl I met at such and such, let's call her and see if she wants to do this. Always had access to the people I needed to get things done because I always vested a lot of time in assembling a team and building a network. I'm gonna end with this. I just wanna tell you something. This is a friend of mine who's a boxer, Evander Holyfield. If you don't, that's him knocking out Mike Tyson. If you don't know who he is, you probably know that in the next fight, Mike Tyson bit his ear off. But I want to tell you, even though it's a sports thing, I just want to close with this lesson because it really changed my life about commitment and hard work. So this was the story. Evander was getting ready to fight for the heavyweight title, and I was at his house just spotting, and he was working out, getting ready for this big fight, and I was counting. And Evander does this exercise where he's basically, his whole upper body's in midair on a table with a giant weight, and he goes all the way down. He does this thing 300 times a day. He does this thing 300 times a day that is absolutely insane, right? 300 times a day. Most human beings, if you did this twice, you would snap in half, and they would get two stretchers to carry you out. So I was like, you really got to do this 300 times a day. So he's exercising one day, getting ready for the fight. And I'm counting. And I said, 299, 300. And Evander stopped. And he said, Jeff, 299 or 300? I said, Evander, it was 300. He said, Jeff, was it 299 or 300? And I said, you did 300. He said, I think it was only 299. He went back down to the floor one more time to do this exercise. And as he came up, I was shaking my head like, seriously, you do this 300 times a day, day in and day out. But I made this mistake. I kind of rolled my eyes, right? Because what's the difference? And he said, Jeff, look at me. And we sort of locked eyes. I tell you what I was really thinking. I was thinking, well, that was a short life. this was not the guy. When a guy like that says, look at me now, I was like, yeah, I need, can I call next of kin before you kill me? And what he said next has nothing to do with sports and everything to do with life. But it literally was an epiphany moment in my life. He said, he looked me in the eyes, and he said, Jeff, the difference between 299 and 300 is the difference between heavyweight champion of the world and every other fighter. And he got up. Guys, I had goosebumps. And I closed my eyes, and I stood. He walked away silently. And I stood there for 10 minutes, and I couldn't move because I wanted the lesson to soak all the way into my soul. Because you know why that is? If 299 is good enough for you today, what's good enough for you tomorrow? 298 is almost 299. The day before that, well, 297, that's practically 298. You know what's happening down the road? Some other person is doing 300, and they will beat you at whatever you are doing. So I went to my office, and I took a pen, and I wrote the number 299, and I made a red circle with a slash through it. No 299s. By the way, I love it when people, after they've heard me tell this story, send me a picture of a no 299 where they live. And then people get it, and they hang it up. I was at work one night. I was writing a proposal, an important one. It was midnight. I finished the proposal. I looked at it and I said, this is good enough. We're going to win this bid. It was one company's contract. We will win the bid with this proposal. So I turn the lights off and I'm walking out. And I glance up at the board and guess what it says? It says no 299s. And I stopped and I said, this is good enough to win, 299. But is it 300? Is it the best? Every paper you ever write, every test you ever study for, whatever you do, are you really bringing your best? Because the people that have the great lives are the ones that don't stop at 299. I looked at that proposal, and I said, it's good, but is it my best? And I said, it's not. This is not the best paper I've ever written. This is not a 300. So I poured some coffee, took my shoes off, turned the lights back on, and I stayed till 4:30 in the morning. When I was done, I looked at this, and I said, this is 300. This is all I got. This is the best I can do. And I felt completely different. I turned that proposal in. 2 weeks later, the customer called me, and she said two things. And I said, what? And she said, first of all, you got the business, hands down. And I said, what's the other thing? She said, I want to tell you something. She said, we did something we've never done in our company's history. And I said, what? And she said, I was at a conference for my industry, which means all my competitors were there. And I said, yeah. And she said, at dinner that night, we were talking about this kind of technology. She said, I told everyone at the table, don't even waste your time with a proposal. Just buy from Jeff. They are so far head and shoulders above everybody else that you're wasting your time even taking bids. I won 5 contracts from one proposal. That is the difference between 299 and 300. If you want to do anything amazing with your life, be prepared to work harder than everybody around you. Be prepared to make that commitment and finish it, because that's what excellence takes. Thank you guys very much for inviting me tonight. Can we do a few couple?
Okay.
When do I actually get my grade? All right, I'll do questions for extra credit. That might help my grade on this speech. Anybody have any questions? Also, the question, if you couldn't hear it in the back, was about mentorship and having a mentor. So in the early days when I really needed a mentor, I did not have one, and I didn't